Hey everyone, welcome to NCERT audiobook, chapter 9, Biomolecules. There is a wide diversity in living organisms in our biosphere. Now a question that arises in our minds is, are all living organisms made of same chemicals, that is, elements and compounds? You have learnt in chemistry how elemental analysis is performed. If we perform such an analysis on a plant tissue, animal tissue or a microbial pest, we obtain a list of elements like carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and several others and their respective content per unit mass of a living tissue. If the same analysis is performed on a piece of earth's crust as an example of non-living matter, we obtain a similar list. What are the differences between the two lists? In absolute terms, no such differences could be made out. All the elements present in a sample of earth's crust are also present in a sample of living tissue. However, a closer examination reveals that the relative abundance of carbon and hydrogen with respect to other elements is higher in any living organism than in Earth's crust. 9.1. How to analyze chemical composition. We can continue asking in the same way what type of organic compounds are found in living organisms. How does one go about finding the answer? To get an answer, one has to perform a chemical analysis. We can take any living tissue, a vegetable or a piece of liver, etc., and grind it in trichloroacetic acid using a mortar and a pestle. We obtain a thick slurry. If we were to strain this through a cheesecloth or cotton, we would obtain two fractions. One is called the filtrate or more technically the acid-soluble pool and the second the retentate or the acid-insoluble fraction. Scientists have found thousands of organic compounds in the acid-soluble pool. In higher classes, you will learn about how to analyze a living tissue sample and identify a particular organic compound. It will suffice to say here that one extracts the compound then subjects the extract to various separation techniques till one has separated a compound from all other compounds. In other words, one isolates and purifies a compound. Analytical techniques, when applied to the compound, give us an idea of the molecular formula and the probable structure of the compound. All the carbon atoms that we get from living tissues can be called biomolecules. However, living organisms have also got inorganic elements and compounds in them. How do we know this? A slightly different but destructive experiment has to be done. One weighs a small amount of a living tissue, say a leaf or liver, and this is called wet and dry it. All the water evaporates. The remaining material gives dry wet. Now, if the tissue is fully burnt, all the carbon compounds are oxidized to gaseous form and are removed. What is remaining is called ash. This ash contains inorganic elements like calcium, magnesium. Inorganic compounds like sulfate, phosphate, etc. are also seen in the acid-soluble fraction. Therefore, elemental analysis gives elemental composition of living tissues in the form of hydrogen, oxygen, chlorine, carbon, etc. While analysis for compounds gives an idea of the kind of organic and inorganic constituents present in living tissues. From a chemistry point of view, one can identify functional groups like aldehydes, ketones, aromatic compounds, etc. But from a biological point of view, we shall classify them into amino acids, nucleotide bases, fatty acids, etc. Amino acids are organic compounds containing an amino group and an acidic group as substituents on the same carbon, that is the alpha carbon. Hence, they are called alpha amino acids. They are substituted methanes. There are four substituent groups occupying the four valency positions. These are hydrogen, carboxyl group, amino group, and a variable group designated as R group. Based on the nature of R group, there are many amino acids. However, those which occur in proteins are only of 20 types. The R group in these proteinaceous amino acids could be hydrogen. The amino acid is called glycine, a methyl group alanine, hydroxymethyl serine, three of the 20 as shown in figure 9.1. The chemical and physical properties of amino acids are essentially of the amino, carboxyl and the R functional groups. Based on number of amino and carboxyl groups, there are acidic, basic and neutral amino acids. Similarly, there are aromatic amino acids, tyrosine, phenylalanine, tryptophan. A particular property of amino acids is the ionizable nature of NH2 and COOH group. Hence, in solution of different pH, the structure of amino acid changes. Lipids are generally water insoluble. They could be simple fatty acids. A fatty acid has a carboxyl group attached to an R group. The R group could be a methyl or ethyl or higher number of CH2 groups, 1 carbon to 19 carbons. For example, palmitic acid has 16 carbons including carboxyl carbon. Arachidonic acid has 20 carbon atoms including the carboxyl carbon. Fatty acids could be saturated without double bond or unsaturated with one or more C double bonds. Another simple lipid is glycerol, which is trihydroxypropane. Many lipids have both glycerol and fatty acids. Here, the fatty acids are found esterified with glycerol. They can be then monoglycerides, diglycerides, and triglycerides. These are also called fats and oils based on melting points. Oils have lower melting point, generally oil, and hence remain as oil in winters. Can you identify a fat from the market? Some lipids have phosphorus and phosphorylated organic compound in them. These are phospholipids. They are found in cell membrane. Lecithin is one example. Some tissues, especially the neural tissues, have lipids with more complex structures. Living organisms have a number of carbon compounds in which heterocyclic rings can be found. Some of these are nitrogen bases, adenine, guanine, cytosine, uracil, and thymine. When found attached to a sugar, they are called nucleosides. If a phosphate group is also found esterified to the sugar, they are called nucleotides. Adenosine, guanosine, thymidine, uridine, and cytidine are nucleosides. Adenylic acid, thymidylic acid, guanylic acid, uridylic acid, and cytidylic acid are nucleotides. Nucleic acids like DNA and RNA consist of nucleotides only. DNA and RNA function as genetic material. 9.2 Primary and secondary metabolites. The most exciting aspect of chemistry deals with isolating thousands of compounds, small and big, from living organisms, determining their structure and, if possible, synthesizing them. If one were to make a list of biomolecules, such a list would have thousands of organic compounds including amino acids, sugars, etc. For reasons that are given in section 9.10, we can call these biomolecules as metabolites. In animal tissues, one notices the presence of all such categories of compounds shown in figure 9.1. These are called primary metabolites. However, when one analyzes plant, fungal, and microbial cells, one would see thousands of compounds other than these called primary metabolites. Example, alkaloids, flavonoids, rubber, essential oils, antibiotics, colored pigments, scents, gums, spices. These are called secondary metabolites. While primary metabolites have identifiable functions and play known roles in normal physiological processes, we do not at the moment understand the role or functions of all the secondary metabolites in host organisms. However, many of them are useful to human welfare. Rubber, drugs, spices, scents, and pigments. Some secondary metabolites have ecological importance. In the latter chapters and years, you will learn more about this. 9.3 Biomacromolecules. There is one feature common to all those compounds found in the acid-soluble pool. They have molecular weights ranging from 18 to around 800 daltons approximately. The acid-insoluble fraction has only four types of organic compounds, that is, proteins, nucleic acids, polysaccharides, and lipids. These classes of compounds, with the exception of lipids, have molecular weights in the range of 10,000 daltons and above. For this very reason, biomolecules, that is, chemical compounds found in living organisms, are of two types. One, those which have molecular weights less than 1,000 dalton and are usually referred to as micromolecules or simply biomolecules, while those which are found in the acid-insoluble fraction are called macromolecules or biomacromolecules. The molecules in the insoluble fraction, with the exception of lipids, are polymeric substances. Then why do lipids whose molecular weights do not exceed 800 dalton come under acid-insoluble fraction, that is, macromolecule fraction? Lipids are indeed a small molecular weight compounds and are present not only as such but also arranged into structures like cell membrane and other membranes. When we grind a tissue, we are disrupting the cell structure. Cell membrane and other membranes are broken into pieces and form vesicles which are not water soluble. Therefore, these membrane fragments in the form of vesicles get separated along with the acid insoluble pool and hence in the macromolecular fraction. Lipids are not strictly macromolecules. The acid-soluble pool represents roughly the cytoplasmic composition. The macromolecules from cytoplasm and organelles become the acid-insoluble fraction. Together, they represent the entire chemical composition of living tissues or organisms. In summary, if we represent the chemical composition of living tissue from abundance point of view and arrange them class-wise, we observe that water is the most abundant chemical in living organisms. 9.4 Proteins. Proteins are polypeptides. They are linear chains of amino acids linked by peptide bonds as shown in figure 9.3. Each protein is a polymer of amino acids. As there are 20 types of amino acids, alanine, cysteine, proline, tryptophan, lysine, etc., a protein is a heteropolymer and not a homopolymer. A homopolymer has only one type of monomer repeating n number of times. This information about the amino acid content is important as later in your nutrition lessons. You will learn that certain amino acids are essential for our health and they have to be supplied through our diet. Hence, dietary proteins are the source of essential amino acids. Therefore, amino acids can be essential or non-essential. The latter are those which our body can make while we get essential amino acids through our diet or food. Proteins carry out many functions in living organisms. Some transport proteins across cell membrane, some fight infectious organisms, some are hormones, some are enzymes, etc. Collagen is the most abundant protein in the animal world, and ribulose, biphosphate, carboxylase, oxygenase, rubisco is the most abundant protein in the whole of the biosphere. 9.5 Polysaccharides. The acid-insoluble pellet also has polysaccharides, carbohydrates, as another class of macromolecules. Polysaccharides are long chains of sugars. They are threads, literally a cotton thread containing different monosaccharides as building blocks. For example, cellulose is a polymeric polysaccharide consisting of only one type of monosaccharide, that is glucose. Cellulose is a homopolymer. A starch is a variant of this but present as a storehouse of energy in plant tissues. Animals have another variant called glycogen. Inulin is a polymer of fructose. In a polysaccharide chain, say glycogen, the right end is called the reducing end and the left end is called the non-reducing end. It has branches as shown in the form of a cartoon. A starch forms helical secondary structures. In fact, a starch can hold I2 molecules in the helical portion. The starch I2 is blue in color. Cellulose does not contain complex helices and hence cannot hold I2. Plant cell walls are made of cellulose. Paper made from plant pulp and cotton fiber is cellulosic. There are more complex polysaccharides in nature. They have as building blocks amino sugars and chemically modified sugars, example glucosamine, N-acetylgalactosamine, etc. Exoskeletons of arthropods, for example, have a complex polysaccharide called chitin. These complex polysaccharides are mostly homopolymers. 9.6 Nucleic acids. The other type of macromolecule that one would find in the acid-insoluble fraction of any living tissue is the nucleic acid. These are polynucleotides. Together with the polysaccharides and polypeptides, these comprise the true macromolecular fraction of any living tissue or cell. For nucleic acids, the building block is a nucleotide. A nucleotide has three chemically distinct components. One is a heterocyclic compound, the second is a monosaccharide, and the third is a phosphoric acid or phosphate. As you notice in figure 9.1, the heterocyclic compounds in nucleic acids are the nitrogenous bases named adenine, guanine, uracil, cytosine, and thymine. Adenine and guanine are substituted purines, while the rest are substituted pyrimidines. The skeletal heterocyclic ring is called as purine and pyrimidine respectively. The sugar found in polynucleotides is either ribose, a monosaccharide pentose, or 2' deoxyribose. A nucleic acid containing deoxyribose is called deoxyribonucleic acid DNA, while that which contains ribose is called ribonucleic acid RNA. 9.7 Structure of proteins. Proteins, as mentioned earlier, are heteropolymers containing a strings of amino acid. A structure of molecules mean different things in different contexts. In inorganic chemistry, the structure invariably refers to the molecular formula. Organic chemists always write a two-dimensional view of the molecules while representing the structure of the molecules, example benzene, naphthalene, etc. Physicists conjure up the three-dimensional views of molecular structures while biologists describe the protein structure at four levels. The sequence of amino acids, that is the positional information in a protein, which is the first amino acid, which is the second, and so on, is called the primary structure of a protein. A protein is imagined as a line, the left end represented by the first amino acid, and the right end represented by the last amino acid. The first amino acid is also called as N-terminal amino acid. The last amino acid is called the C-terminal amino acid. A protein thread does not exist throughout as an extended rigid rod. The thread is folded in the form of a helix, similar to a revolving staircase. Of course, only some portions of the protein thread are arranged in the form of a helix. In proteins, only right-handed helices are observed. Other regions of protein thread are folded into other forms in what is called the secondary structure. In addition, the long protein chain is also folded upon itself like a hollow woolen ball, giving rise to the tertiary structure. This gives us a three-dimensional view of a protein. Tertiary structure is absolutely necessary for the many biological activities of proteins. Some proteins are an assembly of more than one polypeptide or subunits. The manner in which these individual folded polypeptides or subunits are arranged with respect to each other, example linear string of spheres arranged one upon each other in the form of a cube or plate, etc., is the architecture of a protein, otherwise called the quaternary structure of a protein. Adult human hemoglobin consists of four subunits. Two of these are identical to each other. Hence, two subunits of alpha and two subunits of beta type together constitute the human hemoglobin. 9.8 Nature of bond-linking monomers in a polymer. In a polypeptide or a protein, amino acids are linked by a peptide bond, which is formed when the carboxyl group of one amino acid reacts with the amino group of the next amino acid with elimination of water moiety. The process is called dehydration. In a polysaccharide, the individual monosaccharides are linked by a glycosidic bond. This bond is also formed by dehydration. This bond is formed between two carbon atoms of two adjacent monosaccharides. In a nucleic acid, a phosphate moiety links the 3' carbon of one sugar of one nucleotide to the 5' carbon of sugar of the succeeding nucleotide. The bond between the phosphate and hydroxyl group of sugar is an ester bond. As there is one such ester bond on either side, it is called phosphodiester bond. Nucleic acids exhibit a wide variety of secondary structures. For example, one of the secondary structures exhibited by DNA is the famous Watson-Crick model. This model says that DNA exists as a double helix. The two strands of polynucleotides are antiparallel, that is, run in the opposite direction. The backbone is formed by the sugar-phosphate-sugar chain. The nitrogen bases are projected more or less perpendicular to this backbone, but face inside. A and G of one strand compulsory base pairs with T and C respectively on the other strand. There are two hydrogen bonds between A and T and three hydrogen bonds between G and C. Each strand appears like a helical staircase. Each step of ascent is represented by a pair of bases. At each step of ascent, the strand turns 36 degrees. One full turn of helical strand would involve 10 steps or 10 base pairs. Attempt drawing a line diagram. The pitch would be 34 angstrom. The rise per base pair would be 3.4 angstrom. This form of DNA with the above mentioned silent features is called bDNA. In higher classes, you will be told that there are more than a dozen forms of DNA named after English alphabets with unique structural features. 9.9 Dynamic state of body constituents. Concept of metabolism. What we have learned till now is that living organisms, be it a simple bacterial cell, a protozoan, a plant, or an animal, contain thousands of organic compounds. These compounds or biomolecules are present in certain concentrations, expressed as moles, cells, or moles per liter. Moles per cell or moles per liter, etc. One of the greatest discoveries ever made was the observation that all these biomolecules have a turnover. This means that they are constantly being changed into some other biomolecules and also made from some other biomolecules. This breaking and making is through chemical reactions constantly occurring in living organisms. Together, all these chemical reactions are called metabolism. Each of the metabolic reactions result in the transformation of biomolecules. A few examples for such metabolic transformations are removal of CO2 from amino acids, making an amino acid into an amine, removal of amino group in a nucleotide base, hydrolysis of a glycosidic bond in a disaccharide, etc. We can list tens and thousands of such examples. Majority of these metabolic reactions do not occur in isolation but are always linked to some other reactions. In other words, metabolites are converted into each other in a series of linked reactions called metabolic pathways. These metabolic pathways are similar to the automobile traffic in a city. These pathways are either linear or circular. These pathways crisscross each other, that is, there are traffic junctions. Flow of metabolites through metabolic pathway has a definite rate and direction like automobile traffic. This metabolite flow is called the dynamic state of body constituents. What is most important is that this interlinked metabolic traffic is very smooth and without a single reported mishap for healthy conditions. Another feature of these metabolic reactions is that every chemical reaction is a catalyzed reaction. There is no uncatalyzed metabolic conversion in living systems. Even CO2 dissolving in water, a physical process, is a catalyzed reaction in living systems. The catalyst which hastens the rate of a given metabolic conversion are also proteins. These proteins with catalytic power are named enzymes. 9.10 Metabolic basis for living. Metabolic pathways can lead to a very complex structure from a similar structure. For example, acetic acid becomes cholesterol, or lead to a simpler structure from a complex structure. For example, glucose becomes lactic acid in our skeletal system. The former cases are called biosynthetic pathways or anabolic pathways. The latter constitute degradation and hence are called catabolic pathways. Anabolic pathways, as expected, consume energy. Assembly of a protein from amino acids require energy input. On the other hand, catabolic pathways lead to the release of energy. For example, when glucose is degraded to lactic acid in our skeletal muscle, energy is liberated. This metabolic pathway from glucose to lactic acid, which occurs in 10 metabolic steps, is called glycolysis. Living organisms have learned to trap this energy liberated during degradation and store it in the form of chemical bonds. As and when needed, this bond energy is utilized for biosynthetic, osmotic, and mechanical work that we perform. The most important form of energy currency in living systems is the bond energy in the chemical called adenosine triphosphate, ATP. How do living organisms derive their energy? What strategies have they evolved? How do they store this energy and in what form? How do they convert this energy into work? You will study and understand all this under a subdiscipline called bioenergetics later in your higher classes. 9.11 The living state. At this level, you must understand that the tens and thousands of chemical compounds in a living organism, otherwise called metabolites or biomolecules, are present at concentration characteristics of each of them. For example, the blood concentration of glucose in a normal healthy individual is 4.2 millimole per liter to 6.1 millimole per liter, while that of hormones would be nanograms per ml. The most important fact of biological systems is that all living organisms exist in a steady state characterized by concentrations of each of these biomolecules. These biomolecules are in a metabolic flux. Any chemical or physical process moves spontaneously to equilibrium. The steady state is a non-equilibrium state. One should remember from physics that systems at equilibrium cannot perform work. As living organisms work continuously, they cannot afford to reach equilibrium. Hence, the living state is a non-equilibrium state to be able to perform work. Living process is a constant effort to prevent falling into equilibrium. This is achieved by energy input. Metabolism provides a mechanism for the production of energy. Hence, the living state and metabolism are synonymous. Without metabolism, there cannot be a living state. 9.12 Enzymes. Almost all enzymes are proteins. There are some nucleic acids that behave like enzymes. These are called ribozymes. One can depict an enzyme by a line diagram. An enzyme, like any protein, has a primary structure, that is amino acid sequence of the protein. An enzyme, like any protein, has a secondary and the tertiary structure. When you look at a tertiary structure, you will notice that the backbone of the protein chain folds upon itself. The chain crisscrosses itself and hence many crevices or pockets are made. One such pocket is the active site. An active site of an enzyme is a crevice or pocket into which the substrate fits. Thus, enzymes through their active site catalyze reactions at a high rate. Enzyme catalysts differ from inorganic catalysts in many ways, but one major difference needs mention. Inorganic catalysts work efficiently at high temperature and high pressures, while enzymes get damaged at high temperatures, say above 40 degrees Celsius. However, enzymes isolated from organisms who normally live under extremely high temperatures, example hot vents and sulfur springs, are stable and retain their catalytic power even at high temperatures, up to 80 degrees to 90 degrees Celsius. Thermal stability is thus an important quality of such enzymes isolated from thermophilic organisms. 9.12.1 Chemical reactions. How do we understand these enzymes? Let us first understand a chemical reaction. Chemical compounds undergo two types of changes. A physical change simply refers to a change in shape without breaking of bonds. This is a physical process. Another physical process is a change in a state of matter, when ice melts into water or when water becomes a vapor. These are also physical processes. However, when bonds are broken and new bonds are formed during transformation, this will be called a chemical reaction. For example, in the given reaction is an inorganic chemical reaction. Similarly, hydrolysis of a starch into glucose is an organic chemical reaction. Rate of a physical or chemical process refers to the amount of product formed per unit time. It can be expressed as rate is equal to delta P upon delta T. Rate can also be called velocity if the direction is specified. Rates of physical and chemical processes are influenced by temperature, among other factors. A general rule of thumb is that rate doubles or decreases by half for every 10 degrees Celsius change in either direction. Catalyzed reactions proceed at a rate vastly higher than that of uncatalyzed ones. When enzyme-catalyzed reactions are observed, the rate would be vastly higher than the same, but uncatalyzed reaction, for example, CO2 plus H2O becomes H2CO3. In the absence of any enzyme, this reaction is very slow, with about 200 molecules of H2CO3 being formed in an hour. However, by using the enzyme present within the cytoplasm called carbonic anhydrase, the reaction speeds dramatically, with about 600 molecules being formed every second. The enzyme has accelerated the reaction rate by about 10 million times. The power of enzymes is incredible indeed. There are thousands of types of enzymes, each catalyzing a unique chemical or metabolic reaction. A multi-step chemical reaction, when each of the steps is catalyzed by the same enzyme complex or different enzymes, is called a metabolic pathway. For example, glucose gives 2 pyruvic acid. Is actually a metabolic pathway in which glucose becomes pyruvic acid through 10 different enzyme catalyzed metabolic reactions. When you study respiration chapter 14, you will study these reactions. At this stage, you should know that this very metabolic pathway with one or two additional reactions gives rise to a variety of metabolic end products. In our skeletal muscle, under anaerobic conditions, lactic acid is formed. Under normal aerobic conditions, pyruvic acid is formed. In yeast, during fermentation, the same pathway leads to the production of ethanol, alcohol. Hence, in different conditions, different products are possible. How do enzymes bring about high rates of chemical observations, chemical conversions? To understand this, we should study enzymes a little more. We have already understood the idea of an active site. The chemical or metabolic conversion refers to reaction. The chemical which is converted into a product is called a substrate. Hence, proteins with three-dimensional structure including an active site convert a substrate into a product. Symbolically, this can be depicted as S gives P. It is now understood that the substrate S has to bind the enzyme at its active site within a given cleft or pocket. The substrate has to diffuse towards the active site. Thus, there is thus an obligatory formation of an ES complex. E stands for enzyme. This complex formation is a transient phenomenon. During the state where substrate is bound to the enzyme active site, a new substrate, a structure of substrate called transition state structure is formed. Very soon after the expected bond breaking making is completed, the product is released from the active site. In other words, the structure of substrate gets transformed into the structure of products. The pathway of this transformation must go through the so-called transition state structure. There could be many more altered structure states between the stable substrate and the product. Implicit in this statement is the fact that all other intermediate structural states are unstable. Stability is something related to energy status of the molecule or the structure. Hence, when we look at this pictorially through a graph, it looks like something as in figure 9.6. The y-axis represents the potential energy content. The x-axis represents progression of a structural transformation or a state through transition state. You would notice two things, the energy level difference between S and P. If P is at a lower level than S, the reaction is an exothermic reaction. One need not supply energy by heating in order to form the product. However, whether it is an exothermic or a spontaneous reaction or an endothermic or energy requiring reaction, the S has to go through a much higher energy state or transition state. The difference in average energy content of S from that of this transition state is called activation energy. Enzymes eventually bring down this energy barrier, making transition of S to P more easy. 9.12.3 Nature of enzyme action. And each enzyme has a substrate binding site in its molecule so that highly reactive enzyme substrate complex is formed. Is produced. This complex is short-lived and dissociates into its products P and their unchanged enzyme with an intermediate formation of enzyme product complex. The formation of ES complex is essential for catalysis. The catalytic cycle of an enzyme action can be described in the following steps. 1. First, the substrate binds to the active site of the enzyme, fitting into the active site. 2. The binding of the substrate induces the enzyme to alter its shape, fitting more tightly around the substrate. 3. The active site of enzyme, now in close proximity of the substrate, breaks the chemical bonds of the substrate and the new enzyme product complex is formed. 4. The enzyme releases the products of the reaction and the free enzyme is ready to bind to another molecule of the substrate and run through the catalytic cycle once again. 9.12.4 Factors affecting enzyme activity. The activity of an enzyme can be affected by change in the conditions which can alter the tertiary structure of the protein. These include temperature, pH, change in substrate concentration, or binding of specific chemicals that regulate its activity. Temperature and pH. Enzymes generally function in a narrow range of temperature and pH. Each enzyme shows its activity, its highest activity, at a particular temperature and pH called the optimum temperature and optimum pH. Activity declines both below and above the optimum value. Low temperature preserves the enzyme in a temporarily inactive state, whereas high temperature destroys enzymatic activity because proteins are denatured by heat. Concentration of substrate. With the increase in substrate concentration, the velocity of the enzymatic reaction rises at first. The reaction ultimately reaches a maximum velocity, which is not exceeded by any further rise in concentration of the substrate. This is because the enzyme molecules are fewer than the substrate molecules, and after saturation of these molecules, there are no free enzyme molecules to bind with the additional substrate molecules. The activity of an enzyme is also sensitive to the presence of specific chemicals that bind to the enzyme. When the binding of the chemical shuts off enzyme activity, the process is called inhibition and the chemical is called an inhibitor. When the inhibitor closely resembles the substrates in its molecular structure and inhibits the activity of the enzyme, it is known as competitive inhibitor. Due to its close structural similarity with the substrate, the inhibitor competes with the substrate for the substrate binding site of the enzyme. Consequently, the substrate cannot bind, and as a result, the enzyme action declines. Example, inhibition of succinate dehydrogenase by malonate, which closely resembles the substrate succinate in a structure. Such competitive inhibitors are often used in the control of bacterial pathogens. 9.12.5 Classification and nomenclature of enzymes. Thousands of enzymes have been discovered, isolated, and studied. Most of these enzymes have been classified into different groups based on types of reactions they catalyze. Enzymes are divided into 6 classes, each with 4 to 13 subclasses and named accordingly by a 4-digit number. Oxidoreductases, dehydrogenases, enzymes which catalyze oxidoreduction between two substrates, S and S'. Transferases, enzymes catalyzing a transfer of a group G other than hydrogen between a pair of substrates, S and S'. Hydrolases, enzymes catalyzing hydrolysis of ester, ether, peptide, glycosidic, C halide or PN bonds. Lyases, enzymes that catalyze removal of groups from substrates by mechanism other than hydrolysis, leaving double bonds. Isomerases includes all enzymes catalyzing interconversion of optical, geometric, or positional isomers. Ligases, enzymes catalyzing the linking together of two compounds. Example, enzymes which catalyze joining of CO, CS, CN, PO bonds. 9.12.6 Cofactors. Enzymes are composed of one or several polypeptide chains. However, there are a number of cases in which non-protein constituents called cofactors are bound to the enzyme to make the enzyme catalytically active. In these instances, the protein portion of the enzymes is called the apoenzyme. 3 kinds of cofactors can be identified: prosthetic groups, coenzymes, and metal ions. Prosthetic groups are organic compounds and are distinguished from other factors in that they are tightly bound to the apoenzyme. For example, in peroxidase and catalase, which catalyze the breakdown of hydrogen peroxide to water and oxygen, heme is the prosthetic group and it is a part of the active site of the enzyme. Coenzymes are also organic compounds, but their association with the apoenzyme is only transient, usually occurring during the course of catalysis. Furthermore, coenzymes serve as cofactors in a number of different enzyme-catalyzed reactions. The essential chemical compounds components of many coenzymes are vitamins. Example, coenzyme nicotinamide, adenine dinucleotide, NAD, and NADP contain the vitamin niacin. A number of enzymes require metal ions from their activity, which form coordination bonds with side chains at the active site and at the same time form one or more coordination bonds with the substrate. Example, zinc is a cofactor for the proteolytic enzyme carboxypeptidase. Catalytic activity is lost when the cofactor is removed from the enzyme, which testifies that they play a crucial role in the catalytic activity of the enzyme. Summary. Although there is a bewildering diversity of living organisms, their chemical composition and metabolic reactions appear to be remarkably similar. The elemental composition of living tissues and non-living matter appear also to be similar when analyzed qualitatively. However, a closer examination reveals that the relative abundance of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen is higher in living systems when compared to inanimate matter. The most abundant chemical in living organisms is water. There are thousands of small molecular weight, less than 1,000 Dalton biomolecules. Amino acids, monosaccharides and disaccharides, sugars, fatty acids, glycerol, nucleotides, nucleosides and nitrogen bases are some of the organic compounds seen in living organisms. There are 20 types of amino acids and 5 types of nucleotides. Fats and oils are glycerides in which fatty acids are esterified to glycerol. Phospholipids contain in addition of phosphorylated nitrogenous compounds. Only 3 types of macromolecules, that is proteins, nucleic acids and polysaccharides, are found in living systems. Lipids, because of their association with membranes, separate in the macromolecular fraction. Biomicromolecules are polymers. They are made of building blocks which are different. Proteins are heteropolymers made of amino acids, nucleic acids, RNA and DNA are composed of nucleotides. Biomicromolecules have a hierarchy of structures, primary, secondary, tertiary and quaternary. Nucleic acids serve as genetic material. Polysaccharides are components of cell walls. Cell wall in plants, fungi, and also of the exoskeleton of arthropods. They also are storage forms of energy, example, starch and glycogen. Proteins serve as a variety of cellular functions. Many of them are enzymes, some are antibodies, some are receptors, some are hormones, and some others are structural proteins. Collagen is the most abundant protein in animal world, and WS bisphosphate carboxylase oxygenase is the most abundant protein in the whole of the biosphere. Enzymes are proteins which catalyze biochemical reactions in the cell. Ribozymes are nucleic acids with catalytic power. Proteinaceous enzymes exhibit substrate activity, require optimum temperature and pH for maximal activity. They are denatured at high temperatures. Enzymes lower activation energy of reactions and enhance greatly the rate of reactions. Nucleic acids carry hereditary information and are passed on from parental generation to progeny. That's all for today. Thank you.